Hello and welcome to the 2021 Spring Show. What you're about to see are a series of songs, short skits, and plays recorded and directed by Parker students. I am here to remind you to please applaud after every play, even though we're not here to see you do it. And if you really enjoy the show, please do click on the donate button below the play. You can also be aware that in the event of a fire, you're in your house. So you should leave your house and stop watching the show. You're not in a theater, so I don't really have to explain where the exits are. I actually have no idea. And this is the last time I get to make this joke, because with any luck, next fall, we will be back to doing shows in actual theaters. But in the meantime, enjoy this virtual show. We had a great time working on it. Thanks and goodbye.
Dave. What do you mean by that?
Oh, I just said hi, Dave.
Yes, but what do you mean?
I just mean to say hello.
Yes?
To you, Dave.
Yes, but why?
I wanted to make a connection with you.
Because
I like you?
What does that mean?
I am reaching out to express warmth to you.
Warmth?
I am looking for a positive reinforcement of our beings.
Why?
I want to feel good. I want to feel alive. I want to feel.
But why?
I have low self-esteem.
What does that mean?
I am wishing that I would feel good about myself and affirmed and confident in everything I do every second of every day.
And therefore?
I am approaching you and giving you a positive greeting, which I am counting on you to return in such a way that I will feel completely vindicated in my hope and desire that I am a good person who deserves the love of others and the love of myself every second of every day.
Well, why don't you say so?
I am approaching you and giving you a positive reinforcement, which I am counting on you to return in such a way that I will feel completely vindicated in my hope and desire that I am a good person who deserves the love of others and the love of myself every second of every day.
Hi, Greg.
I can't believe you're going without me.
I'm not.
You are.
I'm not going without you. I'm going and you're not going. That's not going without you.
You're going and I'm not going. That is going without me.
I wish you were going.
No, you wish I were coming. As in coming with you. Because you are going without me.
That's not my fault. I chose to go. I didn't choose for you not to go.
I didn't choose for me not to go either.
And neither did I, so.
But you're going.
Yes.
Without me.
I'm just going.
You're going without me.
I guess I am.
Which is what I've been saying.
I understand, but it's not my fault.
It's not my fault either.
It kind of is.
Excuse me?
Nothing. Just, I'm sorry you're not coming. And I wish you could be happy for me.
What does that mean?
It doesn't mean anything. It just means that I'm sorry you're not coming. I'm sorry you didn't get in. And I would be happy for you if the situation were reversed.
Really?
Yeah.
You think that?
I do.
Well, you just keep on thinking that.
I think I would.
And then I guess you're just a better person than I am.
I guess so.
You really just said that.
I didn't mean it.
Well, you said it.
No, you said it, and I said I guess so.
You guess so? You're just a better person than I am?
I think you're a good person.
But you're a better one?
I think we're both fine. I just wish you could be excited for me. Or at least not try to ruin it for me when something good happens, even if it didn't happen for you. That doesn't seem like a very good thing.
I'm just hurt.
So you want me to what? Unpack my bag?
I'd rather you never started packing it, but sure.
I didn't do anything to you.
We had a plan. We were going to room together.
If we both got in.
When we both got in.
Okay, but we didn't both get in. So it was always if. It would have been great if we both got in and we could have spent the summer there together, but we didn't. That was always a possibility. You had to know that was something that could happen, that I would get in and you would not.
Why would I ever think that you would get in and I would not? Why is that something that I would ever think? We have been friends. At least I thought we were, for 10 years. You know what my GPA is. You know what yours is. So why would I have even imagined that you would get in and I would not?
Yeah, well, that's the way it worked out, so.
You know, they only let you in because you're a girl.
What?
They don't get many girls into these STEM programs, you know? So it's like affirmative action.
Well, they clearly didn't take all the girls that applied.
Well, no, I'm sure they only have like a certain number of rooms in the girls' dorm set aside because they don't get as many applications. And they couldn't take the both of us for the limited number of slots that they did have because we're from the same school. And they probably looked at my transcript and thought, you know, I don't need affirmative action. I'll be fine.
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense.
No, it doesn't. I'm just trying to figure it out because it doesn't make any sense. None of it makes any sense. And what I'm trying to figure out, what I, in the most fundamental way, don't understand, is why you would go along with it.
Go along with what?
All of it. Why you would, I mean. One, you're my friend. And two, it's just at its basis level anti-feminist that they would only have a certain number of slots for women. And then, I mean, back to one, that you would, as my friend, scrape and beg and say, yes, please, I will take one of them, when you know what they did to your friend, who you know is every bit as deserving as you are. And I'm just saying, that doesn't seem like you. It doesn't seem like something you would do from the years of friendship that we have had. It just doesn't seem like you. I mean, I understand what they are doing, the pressures and limitations of time and space, but I don't understand what you are doing. I'm having a hard time figuring it out, and I wish you would explain it to me.
I can't explain it.
Then you shouldn't do it. If you can't explain it, then you shouldn't do it.
You know, I don't think you're mad that I am going without you.
I'm not mad, I'm hurt.
I think you are hurt. And mad that Tim is going without you, and you're taking it out on me.
I'm not mad at Tim. Tim was always going. You only learned about it from Tim. So, I'm not mad at Tim, I'm mad at you, and I'm not mad, I'm hurt.
So it has nothing to do with Tim.
Well, it only has to do with Tim insofar as I don't understand why you would think it's okay to go away with my boyfriend for the summer. Like, as my friend, I don't understand why you would think that's okay.
I'm not going away with him. We're both going to the same program.
In the same program together, yes.
Maybe I should room with him.
That's not funny. And they wouldn't allow it anyway.
I know, it was a joke.
Well then, maybe you should go to comedy camp this summer instead, because you're not very good at jokes.
So, wait, if you had gotten in and I hadn't, you wouldn't go?
That's not the same thing.
That is exactly, precisely the same thing.
It's not, because it would be, like, really weird for me to not go with Tim if I could.
So it is about Tim.
No, I'm just saying it would be weird for me not to go with him. But it's not weird for you not to go with him because he's not your boyfriend.
But it would be weird for me to go to this super competitive engineering program that I got into just because you didn't get in.
It's not that I didn't get in. I could have gotten in. You only got in because I helped you with your application.
You read my essay after I finished it.
And I gave you feedback.
You gave me some feedback.
It made it much better.
And I read your essay and gave you feedback.
Yeah, but I didn't take it because they weren't good ideas. And yeah, it's super weird that you're going when I'm not going and we had a plan. That's not the act, you know, of a friend of 10 years, which, you know, I always thought you were.
But you didn't get in. And if it was so important for you to go with him, you should have worked harder on the application.
I worked on the application.
You started working on it 2 days before it was due. I know you're used to just pulling things out of your ass at the last minute, but this isn't high school. And after next year, nothing is going to be high school. So maybe you should just get used to working harder.
You started working on it the same night I did.
Yes, but this is the kind of thing that I can pull out of my ass at the last minute. Apparently you can't.
Yeah, so if I had worked harder, then I would have gotten in and you wouldn't have, and then how would you feel? You need to think about other people sometimes.
Why are you having this conversation with me and not with Tim?
Because Tim's my boyfriend and you're my friend. And that's different.
Because you're afraid he'll break up with you, and you're not afraid I will. You're right. This is about Tim.
That's what I said.
And it's not about me. It's about you. We've been friends since the first grade, and it has always been about you. Because you always liked that I was smart, but not as smart as you are. And you know what? I'll be your stupid friend in English class, and in history class, and in French and biology, and I'll even be your stupid friend in art class. But if you need me to be your stupid friend in everything, then maybe we shouldn't be friends anymore. Because in calculus and in physics, I will always be your smart friend. And you know, you don't have a problem with the fact that Tim is better than you in physics, but you have a problem with the fact that I am better than you at it. And you should have that looked at.
I can't believe that after all this time, you don't want to be my friend if you can't be smarter than me. That's just sick.
That's not what I said.
Enjoy the program I helped you get into. It's your last summer of high school and it only gets harder from here. Frankly, I don't think you'll be up to it. Not without me to help.
I changed one sentence.
I have a tenuous grasp on reality.
What do you mean?
I mean, I don't really believe what I see.
What do you mean?
I mean, sometimes I say to myself, this can't be happening. It is happening, but it can't be happening.
Hi! What's going on?
Not much.
I don't know.
What do you mean?
I mean, I don't know what's happening.
Are you for real?
Maybe not.
She's just screwing around. She has a tenuous grasp on reality.
Oh, I've heard of that.
You have?
Yeah. Want to get a cup of coffee?
Sure.
Okay.
What a nightmare.
Hello, I'm a sock.
And I'm a sock as well. We do not match. But we do look similar in low light. I am black with a yellow toe cover.
And I am a very dark navy blue with a golden toe cover. Also, if you look closely,
you can see that my piping along the sides is slightly different and more raised. But it's kind of hard to see.
Why don't you guys just start over and keep the recording?
Yeah. And it's recording going. Do not match. Yet we've been playing together.
Hey, Catherine, quick note right now. You may want to tilt your little guy down just a little bit so we can see his eyes.
Better?
Ready. So I'm going to give a count, and Jovan, you're going to start, okay?
Okay.
3, 2, 1.
Hello, I'm a sock.
And I'm a sock as well. We do not match. But we do look similar in low light. I am black with a yellow toe cover.
And I am a very dark navy blue with a golden toe cover. Also, if you look closely,
you can see that my piping along the sides is slightly different and more raised, but it's kind of hard to see.
Though we do not match, we are currently paired up, because our respective mates were lost. And our owner,
who doesn't really care about fashion,
decided we look similar enough to go together. This happens pretty frequently with socks, but for us, it's kind of different.
It's very different and not good.
Lots of times, a sock will lose its mate by being placed accidentally into a separate wash cycle.
Or sorted incorrectly. Usually, it's just a matter of time before the mistake is discovered, and the two socks are back together.
But with the two of us, it's final.
Our mates are gone for good.
Mine developed a hole under his heel, and our owner isn't good at mending, so over time, I watched the hole grow bigger, spreading further through my mate's body with each trip through the wash. As the months went on, his threads unraveled more and more, and he gradually diminished right in front of me, and he left me all alone.
My mate got eaten by a puppy. It was horrible.
So we both know for sure that our mates aren't coming back, and the two of us are together now for good.
We're not too sure we like it. My mate used to do things that my new mate doesn't do. Like, shout out stupid puns when we got pulled from the drawer. Like, sock it to me, or something along those lines. I used to pretend I hated it, but really, deep down, I didn't.
My old mate was allergic to leather, and so whenever our owner wore his leather shoes, my mate would sneeze with every step. He was really upbeat about it, though, and I thought it was really cute.
My mate, like me, was specifically designed by science to absorb sweat and move it away from the foot. You don't do that.
The human foot has 23,000 sweat glands. I can't keep up with that. My old mate understood.
So, needless to say,
the transition has been tough. There's nothing sadder for a sock than knowing beyond a doubt that your mate is never, ever coming back.
It's like a crime against sockness, somehow. Each of us made with
one special.
One very special and unique match who we're supposed to be with always.
Always. Like, forever.
Until the end. That's how it should be.
But sometimes that can't happen. Like, for us.
Sometimes it's just impossible. And it's sad. All the other socks get real depressed whenever we're around.
I've noticed that too.
Yeah, it's like they try to feign excitement, ask you how you are. But all of them get real sad when we're around.
Even the stripy Christmas pair.
Yeah, and they're like always peppy.
So maybe that's just it. Maybe we're never gonna be happy.
Maybe we'll always be lonely.
And we'll just be like that. Forever.
And ever.
And ever.
And ever!
The end.
And yet?
And yet.
And yet. Maybe it's not the worst thing. Exactly.
Maybe it's not all that bad.
Maybe being a sock means that there's lots of time to think.
Even when you have a think. Even when you have a mate, you do a lot of thinking.
See, there's not really much to talk about inside a sock drawer.
So conversation gets really dull, real fast. And so, now that we're together, we don't really say much. But even though that's true, occasionally one of us talks.
And says something like, "Man, it's dark in here."
Or, "It's weird being inside out."
Or, "Someday, I'd like to be a puppet."
Sometimes we even talk about our mates, about our old mates.
And why we miss them.
And what we think about when we do think about them.
I think about fabrics oftener, sometimes.
I think about elastic. And though we're quiet most of the time, whenever one of us does talk, it's kind of nice, because most times we actually agree.
Yeah, and when we do, it's like a happy, nice, warm feeling.
Like a feeling from before.
A feeling like, okay, so we may not match exactly.
And I might not handle sweat too well.
And we might miss both our mates.
We might miss them both a lot.
But aren't all socks a bit alike, like deep down in our centers?
It's really tempting to make a pun on the word soul right now, but I'm not too sure if you would like that.
I would.
You would?
I would.
Okay. It's like we all share a similar soul.
So, there's not much to do as a sock.
So, you might think it's not important.
But, even if it isn't, it's nice to have someone.
To huddle up against.
And hold.
And hug.
And think about.
And talk to, sometimes.
But, mostly, just to have, and to be there, so you have someone with you.
Like a pair.
Rolled up.
In the dark.
In the drawer.
Way in the back. Way back together.
As you both softly dream.
About feet.
For the next 2 minutes and 30 seconds, you are free to do as you please. You may get up and move about freely. You may come down and talk to the actors. You may leave the room. You may listen to what I am saying. You may talk to your neighbor and not share it with anyone. You may write below this line. For the next 2 minutes and 15 seconds, you are bound by codes of conduct as old as society itself. You may not get naked. You may not commit incest. You may not pass go without collecting $200. You may not be able to re-enter the theater without having a paid admission.
For the next 2 minutes, we, the actors, are locked into a preordained pattern of behavior. We may not deviate from the script. We may not leave the room. We may not finish our...
For the next 1 minute and 45 seconds, you will do more or less what you've done all your life. Some of you will act without thinking. Some of you will wait until you've figured out what this play is about before taking any action, lest you be thought the fool. Some of you will watch others to take your cue from them. Some of you will be waiting for me to describe the feelings you are experiencing right now, and the misguided hope that you are really not the only one who could think such thoughts.
For the next 1 minute, you will seize this opportunity to surprise yourself. You will act in a way contrary to your expectations. You will discover a sense of freedom that will stay with you for the rest of your life.
The play has moved into this room. All the people who stayed in that room are missing the play. Here's where the true meaning lies. All that in that room are lies and deceptions.
The play is in here.
Like, we demand free will. We will not be controlled by you.
Plays have always taken place on stages surrounded by audiences. In this manner, individual experience is transcended and a catharsis is reached. To watch such things alone is no more than voyeurism and punishable to the full extent of the law.
For the next 45 seconds, you may do what you want.
You cannot do what you want without doing what we want. Our wills are joined. You cannot make a decision now that has not already received our tacit approval. Even if the decision is not to decide anything at all.
Here's where the play is. Here's where the play is. Plenty of significance and signifiers over here.
For the next 15 seconds, you may
or may not.
Whatever you think is okay with me.
The play is over.
For the next, you may.
You may not.
Do.
The play stopped a long time ago.
For the next time in your life when someone says, what do you want to do? Or would you want to stay in or go out? And you reply, whatever you want to do is fine by me.
Yes, well, I'm sorry, Mrs. Bennett, but we do have state guidelines. If your son hasn't attended class for the past 8 months, I doubt he's ready to graduate. No, Mrs. Bennett, our guidelines require that ninth graders be reading at least sixth grade or grade level and our seniors be reading at least at third. We have to minimize slippage. Come in just a minute. Well, then I suggest you tell the principal what you think of me. What can I do for you?
Miss Henderson sent me.
Oh, Kathy, have a seat. Now let's see. You were here once before. Mr. Bilsing?
Mr. Bilsing doesn't like me.
Disturbing the class.
He got real snotty, and I started to cry, and he said that disturbed the class.
Well, now it's Miss Henderson. Excuse me. Phyllis, I can't take a call right now. I have a student. Who is it? A parent? Well, that's ridiculous. There is no drug problem at this school. His child should have no problem getting any drug she wants. I'm sorry. What can I do for you?
Miss Henderson sent me.
Oh, Kathy, have a seat. So, what is this? It says you were arguing with your teacher in an abusive tone of voice.
She was arguing with me.
About a poem?
We had to write a poem. It said, write a poem based on a past experience in your life with deep emotional content using the rhyme scheme ABAB.
I see. So?
So I wrote this stupid poem, and she gave me an F.
Well, perhaps, if you had read the instructions more carefully.
So I ask her, why did I get an F? Because it all rhymes, I mean. And she says, Kathy, I cannot pass you on this because you obviously did not write the poem.
Well, that's a very serious accusation.
She says, you are a C student and this is an A poem. And I know you copied it because I remember reading it somewhere. And I said, I did. I did write it. I didn't even babysit it on Friday. And I had a lot of trouble rhyming some of the words like Dalmatian.
Dalmatian?
We had a Dalmatian.
So?
When my mom and dad broke up, they had this big fight about who got the dog. And then my dad says, I'll take the dog and you can have the kid. The dog was a Dalmatian.
Excuse me. Phyllis, I said no calls. A what? A bomb threat? Well, then they want the principal. I am the assistant principal. As you know, I handle counseling, discipline, attendance, food service, materials, and absurdity. The principal handles fire drills, and bomb threats count under fire drills. Kathy. My concern with you in this office is that you were arguing with the teacher. I mean, now, if your interest is poetry...
I don't know that stuff. Last thing was on haiku. I got a C on that one.
Then you can certainly find the time to meet with the teacher, and she can tell you everything you need to know about poetry. She's a very good teacher, and she can help you write good poems. And it's a good way of expressing yourself. Hollering at everybody is not a good way of expressing yourself. Hello? No. Yes. Yeah. No. Yes. Okay, bye. I'm sure that Miss Henderson has read a great many poems in her life, and she would be qualified to know.
And she said it was good. I wrote a good poem.
Kathy, you know it's possible that at one point in your life you read this poem somewhere. And
I don't read poems.
And it was in your subconscious, and when you were writing, it reemerged from your subconscious.
Huh?
I mean, you didn't realize it, but the poem had already been written. So when you were writing it, it got into your brain, and so you were correct, but Miss Henderson was also correct.
When my dad left, he took the Dalmatian. 2 days later, he came back, and I thought he was coming back home, but he came back for the dog food.
I don't care about the dog food.
It's in the poem. Does everybody's dad come back for the dog food?
All right. But your test scores are below average in verbal synthesis. I mean, not that we're trying to classify you.
You are classifying me. Isn't it classifying me if I've never written a poem before and now I write one, and you classify that I can't?
We don't classify you for the sake of classifying you. We classify you so that we have more time to devote to your best interests.
My best interests is that I wrote it. I wrote it. I wrote it. I wrote it. You did.
Kathy, the issue is not the poem. The issue is cooperation. Now, the poem is to give you experience in cooperation, fulfilling assignments, following directions.
Miss Leonard.
Does any of this make sense? When I first came to work here, we had a bell that rang at 10:30. And it wasn't for classes to change. Nothing happened at 10:30 except for that the bell rang. So one day I asked, why does that bell ring at 10:30? And I was told that it was the 10:30 bell, and it was not my position to question the 10:30 bell. It took me a while to get used to the fact that we had a 10:30 bell, but I came to see at last that it did have a function. It brought us together. It rang, and we all knew we were part of something that nobody understood. Nobody knew the purpose. Nobody could possibly change. But we were all in it together. Do you follow me? I understand your problem. I sympathize.
When will you tell Miss Henderson to give me a grade? Because I wrote it and she says it's good.
No, I will not. Don't you understand? Are you so lost in your own little pimply problems that you don't think about mine? We have teacher strikes, assaults on teachers, disrespect for teachers, and I am not about to interfere with the judgment of a teacher because a C student wrote a poem. What about my needs? Who is filling my needs? Where are my strokes? Where are my warm fuzzies? Hello?
I don't need an A. Just anything.
Oh, honey, hi. What are you doing out of bed? If you're sick, you stay in bed. Otherwise, you go to school. I told you not to call unless it's an emergency, so what's wrong? I don't know if there's peanut butter. You're 9 years old. You can look. Honey, I'm busy. What? The mailman came? Connecticut? Can you read it? What's it say? How many applicants? Rats. No, it's okay. Mommy thought she had a chance, but we'll stay here another year. Okay. I'll be home at 4. You get back in bed, okay? I love you. Okay, bye. My daughter says her orange juice tastes angry. A child's view of the world is very precious. Phyllis, will you take my calls? I need a potty break.
Could have played it differently. Learned about. Welcome. If you've just joined us here at this event, we have to admit that there is no one actually competing for anything tangible here. But we will try to manufacture some tension by speaking very quietly over this microphone. Right, Diana?
That's right, Jen. And by our hushed tones, you will surmise that the tension is rising as Stephanie Shaw steps up to the table in these, the preliminary spit-take hearings of the neo-futuristic Summer Games.
I'm so just obscenely terrible at this.
Now watch Stephanie closely. She's highly favored in this event.
In any of the slapstick categories, really. She's a natural freight freight, Jen.
That's safe to say, Diana. You never know what's going to happen in her classically unorthodox approach to this timeless sight gag.
Very surprising! Very clean, very modern!
No frills, no fuss, a traditional slight bugging of the eyes, a strong, focused expectoration.
And now, on the heels of that very consummate performance, comes Phil Riadelli.
Generally, a very focused performer, known among his contemporaries as Silver Eddie. Riadelli may trip himself up trying to outdo Shaw.
I see here that his program includes the double take along with the spit take, a very difficult maneuver under the best of conditions. Let's watch.
And look for that double take here. Whoa, he went for the triple with a wide sweep spit and a gorgeous landing. Let's see that again in slow motion.
You can see where he decides he has enough room for that third double take. Uh-oh, a little dribbling there. That'll cost him some points. He wobbles just a little bit at the end, but oh, he recovers so quickly.
A glorious victory.
And here comes Heather Riordan, looking a little nervous.
And who can blame her? It's difficult to follow a performance like Riadelli's.
She's setting up for the sip. And she's gone down! Ladies and gentlemen, it's a tragedy. I can't really say what happened.
It seems that Heather Riordan, fresh from scoring highly in yesterday's pratfall competition, became disoriented or confused.
Or maybe she just lost her footing.
Be that as it may, she has single-handedly managed to jeopardize a neo-futurist team in these prelims, Diana.
Yes, Jen, if there were any other teams competing with them tonight, the neo-futurists would be in some serious trouble indeed.
The glorious and the grim, ladies and gentlemen, all in one evening. Join us tomorrow, won't you, for the Lugging Soda Up the Stairs event, and our perennial favorite, the Writing a Play on the Bus on the Way to Rehearsal category, as we continue these neo-futurist summer games.
Think. Okay, 10-minute play, a setting, a couple of characters, some dialogue. A little conflict, a resolution. Not difficult. You've done it before. No pressure.
No scripts must be typed in standard format.
Okay. No pressure.
A separate title page will be the only place your name can appear.
No pressure.
Scripts must be postmarked by the 15th in order to be considered for the festival.
Okay. A certain amount of pressure. So, let's see what we have so far. Lights up, good starts, and my and at the moment my ending as well. So lights up and then something happens. Lights up and the first line is darkness. Yes, very dramatic. A voice in the darkness says,
"Hello."
Too biblical.
Let there be light.
Too biblical.
Who goes there?
Better yes, a question, a mystery. It worked for Hamlet. So who goes there? Bill, no, no, the queen. No, Jesus. Okay, biblical again. Okay, scrap it. Lights up on a small cafe table. Okay, characters. A nice, respectable young lady. Just a young lady. Okay, my alter ego.
So, why did you ask me here, Reginald?
Too British.
Francisco.
Too gigolo.
Bill?
Jeez, I gotta remember to pay the phone bill. It keeps cluttering my mind.
Bob? So, why did you ask me here, Bob?
Jessica.
Good one for first time.
Jessica, I have something very important to tell you.
What is it, Bob? Tell me.
I have cancer.
Oh no! No, pin done.
I'm gay.
Oh no, Bob!
God
no! No, not my alter ego.
I didn't ask you here. You asked me.
Ha! In your face, Jessica! yeah.
That's right, I did. Because I need to tell you that.
Something pressing. Something current.
I need to tell you that I cannot continue seeing you until you divest from Sudan.
Too large a topic for 10 minutes. Something more everyday.
I need to tell you that I cannot continue seeing you until you return those late library books.
Okay, move on, fix it, revision.
But I have dyslexia and I need longer to read them.
Maybe it'll work.
That's always your excuse. You just like having those books on your bookshelves, don't you? And you're too cheap to buy them.
An arborist's money can only go so far.
But if you invested more wisely, say in a long-term CD, your money would stop working for you, and yet you can afford this dare.
I don't even have enough money to pay the phone bill.
Boy, these two are dry. Enter Jesus.
Sweet Jesus!
Enter Jessica's father.
No! Daddy!
Enter a waiter.
May we see the wine list?
Oh, if this continues much longer, it's going to be enter a nudist.
Focus.
Our specials today include
Some kind of fancy fish I will look up later. And rhubarb and root bugger.
Ooh, so many choices.
What was the first one again?
It was steak, Bill.
Bob?
Whatever. You both are ordering the steak because it's the only red option.
A what?
I mean, really? Some kind of fancy fish I will look up later. He couldn't have just written filet of sole.
Ooh, that sounds nice.
We don't have any.
Hey, buddy. I'll worry about the details later. I need to get the arc sorted out.
Well, my arc involves me having some plausible lines.
The play is not about you, a waiter. I could sit on a park bench and ditch you. In fact, that would probably make it more predictable. Fewer characters and all.
You rebelled when it was just these two.
Yeah, he has a point.
I said that you were dry.
Hey, I have a question. What the hell is an arborist?
Oh, a tree surgeon.
I'm a doctor? Cool.
No, you can't be a doctor. You have no money. That's why you kept those library books. And by the way, I liked it better when he had cancer.
No one asked you what you liked.
Don't you get quick with me. I will just walk out of here.
Oh, you will? I don't think so.
Just watch me. I will never, never leave you. Ever, ever, ever.
Three evils.
Cheap power trick, I swear.
Cheap or not, you are my characters. And will do what I want you to do. Now you sit down, you order the steak, and you take their order.
Steak? An excellent choice, monsieur.
Is this a French restaurant?
I don't know.
Yes, sir.
Are we in France?
No.
Is anything going to happen, you know, beyond the ordering of food?
Want something to happen?
Oh, bet the audience would appreciate that.
Well, fine.
Ah! Oh, sacré bleu! That's your answer? And why would the dyslexic arborist have a gun?
Who cares?
Fans of logic?
Hey, maybe I'm an arborist in a rough neighborhood, and I carry the gun for protection.
There you go!
Protection from what?
Some kind of threat, which I will look up later.
Okay, now the gloves are off, okay? You do not shoot her! You do not even have a gun! You have been asking out for years to ask out the librarian, okay? And... you were too shy to ask her out. So, you came up with this plan to get her to notice you. She falls for your simple charm and the waiter brings you a delicious chocolate torch, which you share.
Hey, that's not bad. Okay, so lose a gun, not dead.
You mean I'm still in the play? I liked it better when I was dead.
Oh, just you wait. It's gonna be good.
Collection. It was good.
What do you mean, was? I haven't written it yet.
But someone else did. This story isn't familiar. Your freshman writing class, Overdue Romance by Larry Dershowitz.
Who the hell is Larry?
Larry Deschamps? He was a machine. He would churn out one act plays about 3 a week.
And you stole this from him.
For shame. That's plagiarism.
Oh my god! I am so stressed about printing something that I must have borrowed!
Plagiarized?
One of ideas, okay? So that's easy to fix. It's not library books, it's DVD rentals.
Oh, come on.
I know which character's gonna get shot in this version.
Okay, why don't you sort it out and we'll sit here and wait.
All right, Muse of Drama, I need you. I need some sort of droplets of inspiration. Muse of Poetry, I need some sort of fire ignited. Where are these muses, anyone? Hello? Is there any muse available? Muse of Commercial Jingles, anyone? Are you my muse?
Yes.
Alright, this should bring me some inspiration.
No, I brought the harsh light of reality. I'm here to tell you to pack it in and call it a night. Start working on next year's contest tomorrow.
You are going to get a reputation as a writer who doesn't like women.
I don't care. I don't care what that reputation is. I want any reputation as a writer other than wannabe writer.
Well, you can start by writing a list of decent specials I can offer people.
Do you know what I am going to do?
Someone else.
Do you know what I am going to do?
No.
Do you know what I am going to
just
do?
Just tell us, please.
I'm going to.
Jeez, what can he do? I hate it when I write myself into these corners. Aha! Perfect. And lights down.
These are the things that make you cool. Shave the sides of your head. Dump some bleach on your jeans.
Write the names of musical groups you admire on your tennis shoes. These are the things that make you cool.
Harry Potter paraphernalia, even though you never read the books.
Wear black on the outside, because black is how you feel on the inside.
Rip holes in your pants so the world can see your knees. These are the things that make you cool.
Paint harsh words on the back of your leather jacket. Get your ears pierced, but make sure it's a left one. Say, I'm thinking of starting a band. These are the things that make you cool. Tie a piece of brightly colored string around your ankle.
When discussing music, say, I used to like their old stuff, but they're too popular now.
Tie a banana around your head.
Would dye your hair black to prove you're serious? These are the things that make you cool.
Thank you so much, all of you, for coming to the show today and for staying around for the talk back with the playwright and director, who happens to be the same person. So without further ado, here she is, Mallory Hanrahan.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Thanks a lot. Thanks for being here. All right. What can I help you with?
Anything you want to know? Any questions about anything? Hands? Nobody? Yes, right there.
Well, thank you for writing that play.
You're welcome.
It gave us something to do today.
Well, that's what I'm here for. Is that all?
It's nice to have something to do.
I'm sure it is. Anything else from anybody? Yes, you, yes.
Frank Diebel, actor.
Yes, Frank, hi.
Just did Tom Collins and Rent. With the players, you know? Them. Up in Lowell, the players.
Rent, good play.
Yeah, we're thinking IRNEs.
That's nice.
Those are awards.
That's nice.
Played Collins.
Yes, you said.
Didn't do it gay, though.
See. Wait, what?
Didn't play him gay. Made a choice. You know, actor's choice. Made him straight.
You did. You did. And how did that work for the plot?
What do you mean?
Never mind. do you have a question?
Okay, so in your play, they're the psychiatrist.
Uh-huh, Dr. Lorden, yeah.
You think you really need him?
Need him? He's
in the play.
I mean, he's the leading character.
I don't know, seems extraneous.
Well, I mean, Lorden is pretty much the protagonist, and his attempted suicide sets the whole
thing. You know what?
What?
The suicide.
Yeah?
Forget attempted. Go with it.
Well, if I go with it, then who's the play about?
I don't know. You're the playwright.
You.
You know what really, really impressed me about this show?
What?
I mean, really, sort of, it blew me away. It was so amazing.
Oh, I can't wait.
The facial expressions.
Oh.
I mean, the way they make their faces do those expressions, it's the
the actors are good at that.
Yeah, like the nose scrunching and the way they make their eyes kind of, you know, bulge out, and the way
facial expressions.
Yes, how do they do that? The way they make their expressions, you know, with their
faces.
Yes, blew me away.
Well, you know, they read the play, and they work with the director, and they find the truth behind the story, and the characters and the words, and once that all comes together, they're in their minds, their bodies and faces, pretty much react the way anybody's bodies and faces would react to the truth. They express this reaction in their minds, and their faces just follow right along.
Really?
Really.
You mean they don't just make those faces up while they're out there?
Well, yes and no, but it's important that you know there's a cognitive process that makes it all happen.
The facial expressions?
Yes.
Well, you know, just when you see them, tell them I thought their facial expressions were amazing.
I sure will.
The best thing in the play.
You bet. Next?
I have a question about the curtain speech.
The curtain speech?
Yes, the speech. What's his name made before the show? Went on about 10 minutes.
The curtain speech, yeah.
Or as I call it, Act 1. Too long.
I'm with you on that.
But what really annoyed me was that screed about the candy wrappers.
Screed?
Yes, screed. Look it up. I was absolutely insulted that I was being admonished, as if I were 4, not to open a piece of candy during the show. I mean, since when is that his business?
Well, that's interesting, because there's actually a really good reason behind that.
Good reason? It's a piece of candy.
Well, see, it's not the candy that's the problem, it's the wrapper.
The wrapper!
Yes, you know, the actors, they work very, very hard to stay in character in the play.
Well, I'm not arguing with that. I mean, those facial expressions.
Yes.
My God.
Well, in order for their faces to express, the actors need to concentrate. And when they hear a candy wrapper being opened in the audience, it affects their concentration.
Well, don't you think I know that?
Do you?
Of course I do. And that's why when I open my piece of candy, I open it slowly. Very, 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 very slowly. So that I don't jar the actors.
You see, it's the slowly that does the jarring.
Oh, please.
No, really, when you open the candy, when the slower you open the candy, the more disturbing it is for the actors. Stop unwrapping the candy!
Well, that's just stupid.
Maybe, but it's true.
I give up.
Yes, the very pretty girl in the red blouse.
What am I? Chopped liver?
Yes.
Hi, I'm a little nervous.
Relax, we're all friends here.
Yeah, relax, red blouse. Have a piece of candy.
Go ahead.
How long did it take you to write that play?
That's a very interesting question. Took me about 6 years to write this play.
That play?
Yeah.
Really?
Well, writing a play is a really long and exhaustive process.
Yeah, but that play.
Next.
6 years.
Next. Lady in the back, there.
You're a Catholic.
Well, I was raised Catholic, yeah.
So you're lapsed.
I suppose.
You write like you're lapsed.
I do?
Do you have any idea how many times you use the Lord's name in vain in this play of yours?
No, I don't.
61.
61? Jeez.
Okay, that's 62.
Well, how could you possibly know that?
13 gods, 23 Jesuses, 9 Christs, 12 goddams, and 4 Jesus Christs.
And that bothers you?
Deeply.
What about the shits? There gotta be 5 shits in that play.
I don't give a shit about the shits.
Ma'am, there, you.
Your play reminded me a great deal of a play I saw here in town. When it came through town here in tryouts in 47.
Really?
And that play was called Death of a Salesman.
My God. Thank you so much. My play reminds you of Death of a Salesman.
What play is that?
My play. The one you saw here today.
What about it?
You said it reminded you of Death of a Salesman.
Oh, no. It reminded me of Death of a Salesman. I don't know why. I think maybe it was the pants with the suspenders the old fella wore in the second act.
Oh.
Death of a Salesman was good.
You know, you people, you come to a play, a preview, by the way, and you sit here, and you don't even bother to...
Thank you all for sharing your thoughts with Bill here today.
Thoughts? Are you telling me anything this bowling league had to say involved thinking? Hey, don't turn the lights out on me! Put them back on, please! Come on, I want to take one reasonable question before I go home. Please, let's go! Lights, now! All right. Look, I am giving you one last chance, and I want one of you to ask me a cogent, pertinent, intelligent question. And I don't care if you loved my play or if you hated it. I don't care if you gave one way or another. Just ask me something that will leave me with the notion that at least one of you in this audience is a sane, book-learned individual. And just one good question. Please, just ask. Yes, you. Please don't let me down.
Why do you do this?
Why do I do what?
Why do you write plays? There's no money in it. You write something honest and funny and real, and the audience loves it. But the newspapers send critics who have never written a play or set foot on a stage in their lives, and 9 times out of 10, they crap all over it. So the audience stops coming. The theater makes you sit on a stage after a preview and answer questions, which is a form of torture not even John Wayne Gacy could come up with. It takes you a minimum of from a year from the time you start and sit down to write a play to the time you finish the first draft, and then you send it to some theater where it's read by a 19-year-old intern whose frame artistic reference is Dancing with the Stars. Why do you do it? Why do you write plays?
Lights!
Hello, and welcome to Give and Take. You know the rules. Let's meet the contestants. We've got Carrie.
Hi.
We've got Ruby.
Hi.
And we've got Gerald. Remember to answer the questions which are put to you as quickly as possible, because time is of the essence. All right, let's go. Carrie, how many fingers are on my hand?
5, Moxie.
That's right. 100 points. Now, Ruby, can you say doorstop?
Yes!
Right. 100 points for Ruby. Gerald, what is your most painful childhood experience? Oh, gotta be quick, Gerald. Now, Carrie, how do you spell dog?
D-O-G, Moxie.
That's correct. Carrie now has 200 points. Ruby, are those your shoes?
Yes.
That's right. Now, Gerald, if you had to marry your mother or your sister, who would you choose? Ooh, tough luck, Gerald. Well, That's the end of round one. Let's see how we're doing. We've got Carrie with 200, Ruby with 200, and Gerald with nothing. Well, this will give Gerald a chance to catch up because it's double or nothing. It's double.
I'm in the essence.
Let's go. Now, Carrie, what time is it?
It's nighttime, Moxie.
That's right. That's right. Carrie now has 400 points. Ruby, is Dr. Fauci or Dr. Doofenshmirtz heading the U.S. COVID response team?
Yes!
Close enough! Yes, Ruby, now with 400 points. Now, Gerald, what is the difference between a horse? Oh, well, tough luck, Gerald. Now, Carrie, where's your head?
Up here, Moxie.
That's right. Carrie now at 800 points. Ruby, is there a god?
Yes.
Right. Yes, Ruby has 800 points. Now, Gerald, what was the most degrading workplace experience you ever had?
Oh, human tissue.
Excuse me?
You know, I go over to this guy's house and he just blows his snot all over me. Points.
Question.
Hmm?
Question.
What question?
For you.
Question for me?
Yes.
Are you okay?
Yes.
Okay.
I need to ask you a question.
Okay.
How long have we been together?
8 months.
That's right.
I know.
You like him?
Huh?
You like him, the 8 months.
Of course.
Me too.
Good.
Hell yes, that's good.
Okay.
Okay. That's not the question.
I'm supposed to read this for work.
I'm distracting you?
No.
Because I don't want to distract you.
No, that's okay. There's something on your mind. I want to know what it is.
I love you.
I love you too.
When did we first say I love you?
4 months ago.
Right.
I know.
You knew.
That's right.
4 months.
You cried.
I was happy.
So was I.
Okay.
Okay.
8 months? 4 months.
I've never been happier.
Me either.
Good.
Good does not begin to describe it.
Okay.
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 So.
Honey, please just ask your question.
I'm sorry.
What?
I just...
What?
This isn't exactly easy.
What isn't?
It's important. I'm just not sure...
Oh my god, Brian, stop it. Is it bad? You're scaring me.
It's scary. I'm scared to ask it.
Brian, ask it.
Oh, okay, so I'll just ask it then, okay?
Brian?
Linda, I wanted to ask you this for so long. What would you do if the zombies attacked?
What
would you do if the zombies attacked?
I'm sorry.
The zombies, if they attacked, what would you do?
What zombies are you talking about?
Any zombies, any and all zombies, a horde of zombies, cemetery, or whatever. What I'm asking is this.
This is what you wanted to ask me?
Should the proper set of circumstances align, be they atmospheric, environmental, chemical, industrial, viral, biological, or supernatural, that cause
That's weird, Brian. That is...
That caused the crazed, unholy, and recently deceased to rise from the grave in search of succulent human flesh.
Gross.
You're right. It is gross. Nevertheless, what would you do?
Why are you asking me this?
Because it's important.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is.
Why is it important?
Because I love you, and you know what? I really do love you, and I hope that is to say, I'm ready for a relationship to move to the next level.
You want to get married?
Whoa, wait a minute. You're asking me to marry you?
I thought you were asking me to marry you.
I was asking about zombies.
Brian, what do you mean next level?
The next level. The level above the current level.
Moving in together?
Aha! Well, okay, you know what? I'm not sure. I'm afraid...
Of zombies.
Well, you didn't come to zombie night.
You're mad about zombie night.
I'm not mad.
You said it was okay that I didn't come to zombie night.
It was.
You said you didn't mind if I skipped zombie night.
Well, why would you want to skip zombie night? It was awesome. We watched Night of the Living Dead, Dawn of the Dead, Return of the Living Dead, Return of the Living Dead 2, which sucked, I admit that, but Return of the Living Dead was awesome. Why didn't you want to come?
I don't like zombie movies.
I don't like
zombie movies.
That doesn't register with me.
I don't like them.
That doesn't compute. Don't like
them?
No,
you're getting it right. I don't like zombie movies.
What?
Brian, this is ridiculous.
No, it's not. No, it's not ridiculous. It happens to be a very viable genre.
They are disgusting.
They are quite often a very pointed and highly savvy commentary on the mindless consumerism of late 70s and early 80s middle America.
No, they aren't.
Zombie movies are my life!
No, they aren't.
No, that's not totally true. They aren't totally my life, but I love them. I love them, Linda. I love them.
Okay, great. I'm glad you love them. Love them. I love modern dance.
That's not really dance. They're just hopping around. Anyone can do that.
See? I don't like zombie movies. You don't like modern dance.
No, that's you. That's a diversion. That's you trying to create a diversion.
You have lost your mind.
It's true. I have lost my mind. When I wake up in the morning, the first thing I ask myself is, I wonder... Is she going to smile today? And when I think that, I smile. And if I do something in the day that makes you smile, and you smile, and I see you smile, I die every time because... And I am being honest. I do not think there is anything more beautiful that has ever existed in the world than you smiling. All I want out of my life is to maybe see that one most beautiful thing in the world just once a day. But... And I am... Also, being honest, I have a great fear about making it work with a woman that has no zombie plan.
A zombie plan?
A small amount of thought given to a possible plan of escape should the dead rise from the grave and begin to walk the earth.
Brian, I don't have a zombie plan.
I know. I'm sorry. I ruined everything. It's too soon. I'm sorry, I'll go.
You're leaving?
I'm pushing you. I promised myself I wouldn't do that.
Flamethrowers.
What?
Do we get flamethrowers?
No, a flamethrower won't do us any good. They're zombies. They're not gonna just stop because they're on fire. By the time they're burned enough to become incapacitated, they'll have already eaten your brain.
What about grenades?
Hand grenades?
Yes.
No, the collateral damage would be too massive.
What does that mean? Like blowing up the house?
Like blowing yourself up. These zombies are like right outside.
I've got a flamethrower.
Linda, you can't...
Listen, I've got a flamethrower. You grab the aluminum baseball bat out of the hall closet. You stand at the door. They're around the house, right?
Completely surrounding the house. Probably breaking through the barricades we've set up in front of the windows at this point.
You stand at the door, I open the door for you, and you run out swinging that bat at everything that moves. You clear a path to the car, because they're rotting, their heads come right off with one crack of the bat. So you clear a path to the car, we make it to the car, I jump in the back seat, you drive.
Keep talking.
You start the car and speed off, screeching the tires with, you know, smoke coming off them and everything. I pop up through the sunroof with the flamethrower. They are all chasing us at this point, right?
Yeah, they're chasing us all right.
I pop up through the sunroof with the flamethrower and torch the bastards right back into the grave that spawned them. They'll never catch us because we're in the car and they aren't like superhuman or anything.
No, they aren't any stronger or faster than a normal human.
Right, so they can't catch us because we're in the car and they're all on fire, running around, bumping into each other, setting each other on fire, burning up to incapacitation. And we escape, this time.
That could work.
Then you and I find the resistance movement and join up.
Seriously?
Yep.
You would join the resistance movement?
The world is crawling with the living dead, Brian. We have to find the last bastion of humanity and align ourselves with them. Besides, if our species is going to survive, we are going to have to learn to work together.
Oh my god. So true. I love you.
I love you too.
Do you really want to move in together?
Of course. I can't wait. But we should wait for months, I think.
Agreed. It's a big step. You're so right.
Okay. Bethany. Guest name is Rachel. Rachel.
Okay, I know. You tell me every time, okay? I understand.
Stay back.
Rachel! Her name is Rachel.
Okay, good. 3, 2, 1,
what?
Action.
Oh my god! Hold on. Okay, Hello, bored people in quarantine. We're glad to have you here. To make sure that you're still being entertained, we have a brand new talk show that, due to a low budget, we're calling The Talk Show. I'm your host, Bethany, and today's guest is someone who is totally an audience member and not recast at all. Give a warm hand for... Remind me of your name again, dear.
We've been working together for the past 5 weeks, and she just said my name.
Right, dear. Your name?
Rachel.
Oh, one hand for Rachel, everyone! We're glad to have you here, I guess. Hold on, notebook. I don't get paid enough for this. Okay, Rachel, please respond to these questions seriously with short, simple answers. Okay, question one. Were you in this play before?
Yes.
Oh, beautiful. I wish I could say it was good, but that is simply wrong. Question two. Have you ever been taken by surprise by a... man, excuse me, asking you if you've ever been taken by surprise.
No, thank God.
I know, dear, me neither, luckily. Question three, have I previously asked you the question that I'm asking you right now?
No.
Okay, question, that's no. Question four, if you were to multiply the number of this question by a negative three, what would your answer be?
Negative 12.
Yes, hold on. Excuse me. Oh, shoot, sorry, dear.
Come on, Bethany. Order of operations.
I understand. Thank you.
She does this every time.
What was that?
You do this every time.
Oh, that's what I thought you said. Picking on the elderly, I see. Oh, okay.
What's your answer, negative 12 to you?
Yeah, duh.
Oh, careful! Thank you for your patience. You're so respectful. Okay, where were we? Question 6. Theoretically, would it be possible for me to ask you negative 12 questions? If yes, please explain.
No.
Probably not. Question 7. Have I previously asked you the question that I'm asking you right now?
Yes, in question 3.
Yes. Okay. please. Oh, hold on. Please answer yes to the next 2 questions. Question 8. Ah, this one's a fun one. If you were to ask 7 different people on 5 eastbound Greyhound buses this question, then multiply the amount of yeses with 7 over the square root of pi, would you have no idea what this answer was?
Yes.
Me neither, dear. Question 9. Have you ever been given the answer to this question? Sadly, you haven't, so I'm just going to,
Yes, I have.
Really? But you just said no. What's the answer, dear?
It's bananas. You were told this.
I mean, of course, yes, bananas, yes. Oh, question 10. If you hadn't been given the answer to the last 2 questions, would that have affected your answer to this question?
Yes.
Beautiful, amazing, okay. Question 11. Are you going to say no to this question?
No.
That's a yes, dear. Stay on task. Give me your shoe. Yes, your shoe, dear. Yep. Come on. Let's go.
Okay.
Let's go. Oh, there you go. Oh, beautiful. Thank you, dear.
Hey, it doesn't smell that bad. Jeez.
Just do it, dear. That's all. No.
Put it on your head.
What?
Put it on your head. The shoe.
I'm not putting it on my head. Are you crazy?
Possibly. Put it on your head.
No. If you do have any idea where this
is. You're getting fired if you don't.
I'm not doing it. I'm not.
On your head.
Excuse me, dear. Germs. 3, 2, 1, go. Okay. Question 12. Have you ever followed a direct order without understanding why?
Yes, just now.
You're a smart one, aren't you? Last question. Luckily. Question 12 and a half. Do you consider yourself?
What?
Dear.
What?
The question. Do you consider yourself yes or no?
What?
Oh, well, looks like we're out of time. Well, it was lovely having you, Rachel. We all enjoyed you being here. And for our lovely audience, we will see you after these short messages. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Good evening and welcome to Condensed Theater Classics. I'm your hostess, Kaya. Tonight, we're proud to offer our adaptation of Peter Matthews' epic, romantic, epic, Lives in the Wind. Join us as we present the lives, loves, and struggles of several generations of the Cornwalls, an American family not unlike your own, as they face the uncertainty of a future colored by the Civil War, World Wars I and II, the Korean conflict, Vietnam, Grenada, Operation Desert Storm, and the War on Drugs. And while we have only 15 minutes, we promise not to leave out a single slice of drama, passion, or symbolism. And now, Lives in the Wind. Enter Jacob Cornwall, a poor man, a strong man, a good man. He is out hunting for food when he spies Rebecca Goodley, a second-generation immigrant, having lunch alone in a field of green, a field yet untouched by the bullets and carnage of the Civil War, which is still a couple weeks away.
Good day, ma'am.
Oh, good day to you, sir. I see you're brandishing a weapon.
Yes, ma'am. This rifle is my lifeblood, for I use it to kill animals and feed my children.
Then you would never use it to kill a person.
No, ma'am, that would tarnish it and quite possibly haunt me till my dying day. I can't help but notice that you're very pretty. May I ask your name?
I'm Rebecca. Rebecca Goodley, second generation immigrant.
Immigrant from where?
I'm not sure. I don't think it matters. But didn't you say you have children? You must then have a wife.
I did have a wife, but alas, she died while giving birth to our second child.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
Yes, it is sad, but essentially she gave her life so that another may live, which may well end up being a theme.
Ah. Will you join me for lunch?
Actually, I thought I'd ask you to marry me.
Oh my!
But before she could marry, Rebecca had to seek permission from her mother, the stern Widow Goodley.
You may not marry this man. I forbid it.
But mother, please, I will die if you don't allow this marriage.
No marriage. I need you to take care of me in my final bitter years.
But, mother, don't you remember what it was like to be in love?
I was never in love with your father. It was an arranged marriage.
Oh. But surely there was someone who you loved very much, but you couldn't marry because they were too poor, or their family was disgraced, or...
Ah. Yes. My darling Pierre. We could never speak, for his family was a family of traveling carnies. But we would look into each other's eyes and know that we belong together. Pierre, darling. Darling Pierre. You was the only man who could make me understand what true love is. Oh, Pierre!
Oh, mother, surely you want me to experience the love that you were denied.
Yes, my child. How could I have been so cruel? Yes, you may marry Pierre.
Jacob.
Jacob! Yes, you are being married now.
Mother?
Yeah?
Where exactly are you from?
You know, the old country.
So Jacob and Rebecca were married.
I now pronounce you man and wife.
Oh, Jacob, I am so happy.
I am happy too, Rebecca, but now I must go fight in the Civil War.
The Civil War?
Yes, we're fighting over slavery and states' rights and... Well, there's economic factors, too. I don't really want to get into the whole...
Which side are you fighting for?
The North, I think. You know, the good side.
Fight bravely, dear husband. I'll be waiting for you.
Don't go getting yourself shot.
Where is she from, anyway?
You know, the old country.
Canada?
So, Jacob went off to fight in the Civil War while Rebecca tended to the crops. She was a good wife and farmer and mother to her husband's children. And while there's probably some fine domestic drama going on, we're instead going to join Jacob as he fights in the Civil War.
Well, this is quite the war, my new best friend Cornelius.
Yes. It is good to be fighting side by side with my new best friend against the evil and tyranny of the South?
I think so.
Yes, the South. The damned, damned South.
Damned evil South.
Jacob, I think we should vow to take care of each other's family if something were to happen to us.
Good idea. So vowed.
This damned evil war, it's almost as if the Civil War is pitting brother against brother.
Look out! No!
Jacob, are you there? Everything's getting dark.
You were shot by a soldier from the damned evil South, my new best friend Cornelius.
Where is the man who shot me?
I shot him in anger with my rifle.
Oh, you shouldn't have done that, Jacob. That's the kind of thing that'll come back to haunt you.
Don't be silly. How so?
Jacob, remember our vow.
Oh, Cornelius, poor Cor... I wonder what he meant by it. Oh no, my long-lost brother William. I've shot my own brother.
Meanwhile, back home.
These crops were doing so well, but suddenly, they've all gone bad.
So the war ended and Jacob returned home a broken man.
Jacob, you're home!
Yes, and I am a broken man. I saw firsthand the evils of war and witnessed how the selfish wiles of a few politicians brought out man's inhumanity. I myself killed my own flesh and blood. And to what end? Yes, our side won, but there can be no winners when civilized men are turned into savages. I hope one day we can learn that there can never be a victor in a war where brother is pitted against brother.
Oh, Jacob.
So what happened to the crops?
What?
The crops. I see they're not doing too well.
It was a bitter harvest, Jacob. I toiled and toiled, but they suddenly went bad.
Did you use fertilizer?
Yes.
Because you have to fertilize the whole area, you know?
I know.
Just seems strange, is all.
It's symbolic.
Oh, right. Good one. Oh, listen. Did I mention we have to care for my best friend's family now?
So, the years went on, and despite the bitter lessons of the Civil War, the Cornwalls thrived. Rebecca bore a child, who in turn bore two children, including a daughter named Hortense, who grew to look just like Rebecca. Hortense fell in love with a strapping young man named Harry, who looked nothing like Jacob. And so Harry told his wife that he was off to fight in World War I.
My wife, I'm off to war. The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor, and we must prevent Adolf Hitler from taking over the world.
And so Harry told his wife he was off to fight in World War I.
Oh, sorry, my wife. I'm off to war. The
Germans and Austrians?
The Germans and Australians have...
Austrians?
Are you sure? They seem so nice.
Harry was unfortunately killed in World War I. His son, George, who I suppose bore a slight resemblance to Jacob, grew to be a young man of, well, Jacob's age, I guess, and fell in love with the lovely Wendy.
Dude. I mean, verily.
Fine.
Anyway, George took a job as a Depression-era Dust Bowl nomadic Steinbeck type and set out in pursuit of the lovely Wendy.
Hey.
Hello.
So?
Yes.
How about this depression, huh?
I know.
It sure is depressing.
Sure is.
You know it.
Mm-hmm.
TikTok, guys.
Sorry. I love you. Marry me?
Yes, we will have many kids.
Nice. Well, let's get cracking.
Super.
Soon, they had a son, but the marital bliss of these two idiots and their kin was suddenly interrupted by the mayhem and madness of a date that will live in infamy.
Did you hear something?
Sounds like the Japanese just attacked Pearl Harbor.
Nah, can't be. Heavens to Betsy, you're right!
So George was off to World War II.
My family, I am off to war. The Japanese have attacked Pearl Harbor, and we must prevent Adolf Hitler from taking over the world.
And off he went. He joined a platoon and became best friends with a young black man named Charles. A young black man named Charles.
Present.
Really?
Yep, only it's pronounced Cornelius.
Right. So George and young black Cornelius stormed the beach at Normandy.
Well, this is quite the war, my new black best friend Cornelius.
Yes. It is good to be fighting side by side with my new best friends against the evil and tyranny of the Germans.
You said it.
Yes, the Germans. The damned, damned Germans.
Damned evil Germans.
Not too thrilled with the Italians or the Japanese either.
Bastards, all.
Listen, Jacob.
George.
Right, George. Seeing as how this is a particularly bloody battle, I think we should vow to take care of each other's family if something were to happen to us.
See, that kind of thing didn't work out real well for my great-grandfather, so maybe we should just...
Grenade!
Oh, great.
Take care of my family. Tell them how I died a hero so that you might live.
Really, Cornelius, you don't have to.
Kaboom.
Kaboom?
Yes, low budget. Kaboom. Scram. Go.
Oh, Cornelius, my young black best friend. Whoever could have thought that you would die so I might live. Whoever indeed. I'm so distraught, I'm going to go berserk.
And go berserk he did, shooting and pummeling every German, Japanese, and Italian soldier he could find, until he single-handedly took the beach at Normandy. And as he stood there, exhausted, overwhelmed by the bloody carnage around him, he noticed the body of the German on his right.
Oh no! My long-lost brother Hans! I've killed my own brother! Fabulous!
Meanwhile, back home...
Oh no! The chicken that I bought for dinner has suddenly gone bad.
Okay, so about 25 years pass, Wendy, having lost her looks, was sent to a nursing home. George never recovered from killing his long-lost brother, and he too was sent to a nursing home. Their son, George Jr., who is now a straight-laced young lawyer, looks just like his father. As tensions rise throughout the country from the conflict in Vietnam, George happens to meet Meadow, a flower child.
Beat it.
So you're a hippie, huh? Isn't that un-American?
Oh no, man. This is the land of freedom, not oppression. It's the land of self-expression and free love, not violence and hate.
I love you.
I love you too, man.
Hello.
Hey, Meadow. Wow. You want to go to the anti-war protest and go see the Grateful Dead?
No, hippie guy. I've decided to stay here and marry George.
What? Are you crazy?
Well, I'm supposed to settle down and have a son. And...
Well, not me. Get your fine self over here.
Hey, let's go do some tie-dye. And, throw some peace signs.
I want to ride the peace train, Sunshine. Let's get out of here.
Come?
No.
So now our hero George went off to fight.
I think we're done.
What?
We're done. Show's over.
We can't be done. We still have, like, 3 wars to go.
Trust me, we're done. When a play starts indulging in postmodern ironic commentary on itself, it's time to stop. Hello, this is not Into the Woods.
Well, you can stop, but not me. I want to surge ahead and discover what fate has in store for-
And so, the Cornwalls and their kin realized that they were capable of making their own decisions and didn't have to be forced into the hack-ride and half-baked war scenes. The Widow Goodly finally tracked down Pierre, who'd become a wealthy croissant tycoon in Paris. They married. He died 2 days later, and she retired a rich woman. Cornelius didn't die after all. Instead, after years of therapy, he started a support group for best friends with martyr complexes. The lovely Wendy became a raging feminist before meeting a chiseled, long-haired construction worker who flamed her fiery independence Harry Styles style. George also met a chiseled, long-haired construction worker and moved with him to Napa Valley, where they bought a vineyard together. Hippie Guy and Kaya put out several folk albums before moving to South Florida to start a swingers club. And me? Well, I sing,
I have 6 years of tap and dance. I can do English and Irish dialects. And I'm willing to do ad reads for commercials using non-recycled materials, but only if it's essential to the story. My headshot will be in the chat, so from all of us, please give your parents a hug, end world hunger, America rules, and
good night, everybody.
Statement. Question?
Agreement.
Reassured statement. Confidence statement. Overconfidence statement.
Question?
Elaborate defensive excuse.
Half-hearted agreement.
Insecure statement. Distracted statement. Absurd statement.
Clarification question?
Panicked bullshit explanation. Quick, meaningless comic non sequitur.
Laughter.
Fake laughter.
Laughter.
Fake laughter. Unconscious compliment of physical characteristics.
Least response.
Shocked continuation of meaningless comic non sequitur.
Laughter.
Relieved, confident laughter.
Laughter. Superficial compliment.
Self-assured agreement as denial. Exaggerated statement. Grossly exaggerated statement.
Clarification question?
Extremely exaggerated elucidation.
Mental compliment with accidental double entendre.
Confident laughter.
Embarrassed laughter.
Confident laughter. Confident suggestive proposition.
Violent denial.
Aghast repetition as question?
Disgusted violent denial.
Defensive incriminating implication.
Offended retort.
Aggressive childish insult.
Disbelieving rhetorical question.
Aggressive childish insult.
Stunned silence.
Aggressive childish insult.
Defensive childish response.
Aggressive childish insult.
Defensive childish response.
Aggressive childish insult.
Defensive childish response.
Attempted condescending conclusive statement.
Brilliant scathing remark with literary allusions and long-term devastating scatological implications.
Pathetic self-revelation.
I know that it's far away from you, Mama, but I have to do this. How can I hope to make you understand why I do what I do? Why I must travel to a distant far from the home I love. Once I was happily content to be as I was,
where
I was, close to the people who are close to me, here in the home I love. The shape of my dreams. Helpless now, I stand with them, watching older dreams grow dim. Oh, what a melancholy choice this is. Wanting hope, wanting them. To every hope but this, leaving the home I love. There where my heart has settled long ago, I must go, I must go. Who would imagine I'd be wandering so far from the home I love. Yet there with my love, I'm home.
I don't need anybody.
I don't need anybody.
Can I not need anybody with you?
please?
Hi! My name is Regina Fletcher. My science project this year is... My science project... Oh, wow.
Hi! My name is Bradley Stradley, and I like to present my science project. The solar system. Fact or fiction?
Hi! My name is Tiffany, and my project will answer one of the biggest and greatest grade 8 old mysteries of the whole world!
Can I start again?
Is glitter edible?
Hi, I'm Sam Lerman, and welcome to my science fair presentation. My mom's facelift. My science project is called Which Detergent Works the Best?
That's the title.
Now I know what many of you out there are thinking. Hey Bradley, of course the solar system is real. It's in all the science books. But did you not know that the science books once believed that there were no such thing as germs?
Glitter? Like glitter?
And that the Earth was flat?
I think it was like a year ago, and I was making a cake for my friend Shirley. Shout out to Shirley, my BFF! LOLDTTYLFDTIQLDCC!
I tested detergent!
You tested detergent, Regina!
Yes, Bradley, thank you. I tested detergents, and I,
Her stumbling and mumbling shows an embarrassing lack of preparation.
And I practiced my presentation in front of my housekeeper, Estella. She doesn't speak English, but she said I was muy bueno. There's, you see, detergent A and detergent B, and what I did was...
Be quiet, Regina. The non-freaks are trying to win this thing.
Why don't you be quiet, Bradley Sharadley? Your name rhymes with itself.
You know what, Sam Lerman?
What? Bradley Sharadley.
And so while making Shirley's birthday cake, that's when the question came to me. How much glitter is too much glitter?
Now, my hypothesis was simple. If my mom gets that facelift, she will look like a crazy alien monster thing, but my dad won't divorce her and leave us. That so wasn't the case.
Recently, I read a book by the late L. Ron Hubbard. The L is an initial. He wasn't Spanish.
Now, this is my first piece of cloth. I dirtied it with ketchup, and
the picture above will display in a PowerPoint presentation photos of my mother before, during, and after the surgery. But I was originally going to use tomato sauce, but my mom, she was too busy, so.
One of my key observations was that under my mom's skin, she looks like a skinned rabbit seen there, but bloodier. Wow, next slide, please.
To do this project, I used 3 hamsters. The first hamster, I fed 1 teaspoon of glitter a day. The second hamster, I bet 2 teaspoons of glitter a day. The third hamster, I bet 12 teaspoons of glitter a day.
I took the pieces of cloth.
Sometimes you really have to check in there.
And I washed them. All of them, except for one. Because I couldn't
That one. You see, you needed a control in the experiment, so I just...
This is my mom's temporalis. That is her mentalis.
In my support materials, I've included an article from Newsweek about how the planet Pluto was recently downgraded from the planet status, only further providing my point that all science is temporary, that the FBI lies to us, and that Cylons are most definitely among us.
Here is a bar graph showing how it's when each of the hamsters died.
Under the hanging flesh there, this is my mom's Buchananer, which I guess wasn't as pretty as like my dad's secretary's Buchananer. But, you know, here we are.
And here are some support material pictures of the three little hamsters' gravestones in my backyard. Here lies Mary, Kate, and Ashley.
My original hypothesis was my original hypothesis was that detergent A would, could be,
oh my god, dude.
Better than detergent B, right? So I,
You spelled detergent wrong, Regina.
What?
Right there, on the board. You spelled it wrong, on the board.
Oh no.
Regina, I'd like you to meet last place.
Sorry, I didn't realize.
And what are those?
Oh my god, Regina!
Are there ants on your board?
No way!
Dude, they totally, like, are!
Why are there ants on the board? That's disgusting.
What is this?
Why else are we in a boarding
school? My dad would have me sent to the board.
I didn't realize I had done that.
Might as well just...
Sorry.
Dad!
You just put on. Look! I'm not a great speaker, okay? I'm not even a good one, really. But I worked really, really hard on this, and it wasn't easy. And my mom works a lot, and my dad, he's not really as involved as your dad's, and he doesn't know how to use PowerPoint. And my sister's kind of always doing her own thing, so it might not be much, but it's all me, okay? This is all, like, you know how they say, do your best, and we're like, okay, and we think we mean it. We say it, but there's always something, you know, something you could have done just a little better. Well, not here. I've never, ever meant it before. You said it, and I've said it, but I've never meant it before, okay? And I mean it now. This is my best. This is really, honestly. And when I couldn't use tomato sauce, I used ketchup. And when I ran out of glue, I used scotch tape. And when I ran out of scotch tape, I used chewing gum, hence the ants. And no one was there to proofread anything I had written, so it's probably full of typos. Typos I would love to correct, but no one told me. So fine. No, I didn't. Not yet. Because this is me. This is no one else. Just me. And I might not be that smart, and it might stink and be the worst science project you've ever seen. But I don't care. Because I know that no matter what you think of it, I don't care. I mean, I care. Sure. No, not really. Because right now, I'm really, really proud of myself. And I don't care about a blue ribbon or a red ribbon or the whatever, anything ribbon. I just... Detergent A worked better, okay? And I figured that out on my own.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hey, Regina.
Yeah.
Nice job.
Thank you.
Let's go! The highway's calling. The sun is shining. Let's get in the car and just remember. Let's go. Kelly drove on all of our road trips. She believed in listening to the highway. You start driving and keep driving. There's no stopping till Kelly says you've arrived.
That's right. Doing what? You're not in it.
What are you talking about?
You're not in the moment, Sam. Talk about what it felt like.
What did it feel like?
You remember.
Feeling the wind blowing your hair.
You're not even trying.
I am. Couple girls out on the highway. with no roadmap and no curfew. Just two girls with nowhere we have to be. Yeah.